Okay, so let's talk about power. Power is defined as the work done per time. So it's the rate at which work is done. Rate at which work is done. Now, at this stage, we understand work in kind of a new light compared to the beginning. We understand that work are the transactions between different energy forms. So work is the process of energy transfer. So you could also say it's the rate at which energy is transferred from one form to another. That's what power is. So to give you an example, when we talked about gravitational work we now understand is being traded between kinetic energy and gravitational potential energy. And so now we're not just interested in the how much is transferred, right? If you think of this as energy transferred between bank accounts, right? We're not just interested in, are we transferring $500? It's how soon can you get that to clear, okay? So not only how much is transferred, but how fast is transferred. How much? What is the rate at which it's transferred, okay? So that's what power is. It's how rapidly can you get energy from one form to another. I guess I should mention before too long what the units are. The units for power are going to be the units of work over the units of time. So does anyone remember what the units are of work?
Joules.
And how about time?
Okay.
Seconds, and SI, right? So power is measured in joules per second. This does get its own name. It's called a watt. And that's also capital W, which I know might seem confusing. But that's the nature of physics, is there's only so many letters, so some of them get used more than once. Okay. So to give you an example, 100 watts, this is an old incandescent light bulb. Okay. They call them 100 watts, right? 100 watts means that you're transferring 100 joules every second. Transferring from what to what? Well, in the case of a light bulb, write down light bulb, you're transferring it, energy from one form to another. The energy is going from electrical energy into heat and light. So you're transferring energy from one form to another. These are obviously two forms of energy that we don't really touch with a 10-foot pole in physics one. But hopefully you can understand, at least conceptually, that these are two different forms of energy. We're transferring between them, and we're transferring 100 joules per second, and that means we're doing 100 watts. And you may know that if you have a 50-watt light bulb of equivalent type, right, a 50-watt light bulb is not as bright. That's because a 50-watt light bulb only transfers 50 joules per second of electrical energy to heat and light. Okay? The English system unit of power, so non-SI, is called horsepower. So one horsepower is 745.7 watts. So you may know, for instance, that car engines are rated by horsepower. Okay? So what are they transferring between? They're transferring between the chemical energy and the fuel. And in this case, the destination of that energy we can well understand. It's just good old kinetic energy of motion, right? So we're going faster. The car is going faster. So this gives us an opportunity to understand why it is that we don't, why we come up with this new quantity called power. You might say, why don't we just do the work? Well, I mean, why not just talk about work? Well, it's important to talk about not just how much work is done, but how fast can you do it, For example, if you have a light bulb, no matter how dim, it'll eventually output 100 joules, right? Just leave it on all day, right? So it's important that it does 100 joules per second, right? It's the rate at which you can do that. Similarly with your car, when you're trying to brag about your car, you don't say my car can go from 0 to 60 miles per hour. I hope it can eventually make it to 60 miles an hour. If it can't, you should probably not drive on the highways. What you do is you talk about how rapidly that work can be done, right? I can transfer from the chemical energy in my fuel to kinetic energy in a certain amount of time. My car can go from 0 to 60 in 2 seconds or 3 seconds. Well, that'd be crazy. That's some crazy sports car, right? So the smaller that number is, right, the more the power, right? So for a fixed amount of work, there's a fixed amount of work that is required, a certain amount of energy that needs to go here, but if the time to do it gets smaller, then the power gets larger, okay? What we're really kind of talking about, if you want to visualize it, we're talking about the width of the tube here, right? So if you want to, that's just kind of an analogy, right? It's like, not only can you transfer it, but how rapidly can you get it from one place to the other? I'll give you another example, right? A weightlifter, okay? So what does a weightlifter do? A weightlifter takes their chemical energy. We can say, of course, it goes to kinetic energy, because kinetic energy tends to be kind of like the grand central station. That's everything's going in or out of that. But a weightlifter generally lifts things vertically, right? So it's not like they lift the barbell faster and faster, because that energy is then stolen to potential energy, right? So you're just lifting things. So gravity can always, gravity has no issues with, of course, transferring here to here, but the weightlifter, we're interested in how rapidly can the weightlifter get chemical energy into kinetic energy. So for instance, if you have been, you know, you're an Olympic caliber weightlifter, you can lift 500 pounds from the floor up to your head in a couple seconds, right? Now, I can also lift 500 pounds, but I just pick it up 10 pounds at a time, okay? So it takes me much longer, right? The work done is the same, right? Yes, I exert less force, but I just have to do many, many repetitions, right? As far as the work goes, there's no distinction between exerting a large force and doing the lifting all of that in one lift versus me exerting a much smaller force, but then I have to spend, you know, 5 or 10 minutes to lift my 500 pounds up onto the shelf, right? Work does not make any distinction, but of course the difference, the tiebreaker, is time, right? I can't do that in as short of a time as the weightlifter can. The weightlifter can do this in a much smaller time, and therefore is more powerful than me, okay? So it's not about getting the work done eventually, it's about how rapidly can you get that work done, okay? That's what power is all about. Are there any questions on that? Okay, so that's a little bit about power. And you're in good shape to calculate it. You guys know how to calculate work at this point. All you have to do is divide by time. It's not really a big thing. This is mostly kind of a conceptual discussion about why we care about this quantity at all. Actually, computing it is fairly straightforward. I guess I should mention that there is another way to calculate power. I think you have one part of one problem that requires you to use this formula. So I'll put in f delta x in here, not to be lazy. I'll put in the cosine of theta. That's, of course, our work formula in its final form. T typically, so we only care about forces that are in the same direction as the displacement. So for instance, if the theta is 0, then this cosine term goes to 1. So an example would be like a weightlifter, right? They're exerting an upward force, and the displacement's upward too. So it's typical for applied forces for this to angle to be 0. This is typical for applied forces. Well then, let me suggest the following. Displacement over time is average velocity. So there's an alternative formula for calculating power if you happen to have a slightly different set of things lying around and given to you. You can multiply the force exerted by the average velocity of the object. That'll give you the power too. So that's power. And I want to say one more thing about this unit before we move forward and completely switch gears. If you remember at the very beginning of the work unit, this is literally the first day that we talked about it, I said that there was one aspect of the work formula that seems to be in complete contradiction to everyday life. According to this equation, if there's no displacement of an object, then there's no work. And I drew a sharp contrast. That seems at odds with how we might use work in everyday language. For instance, if I said that I'm pushing on this wall all day, okay, I might say that's a lot of hard work to push on a wall all day, right? But according to this, there's no work. So what's the deal? Well, now we can bring to bear the ideas of this entire unit to understand that there's really no disagreement at all. Here's what's happening. We learned that work is the process of energy transfer. When I am pushing on the wall, I am not transferring any energy to the wall. However, I'm getting tired. So what's going on? Well, I am doing work. It's just I'm not doing work on the wall. I'm doing work on myself. There is an energy transfer. Here's where it is. Chemical energy from the breakfast I ate this morning is getting transferred to my muscles. And my muscles are displacing. If you had a microscope, you would see my muscle fibers contracting. So there is no work on the wall because I'm not displacing the wall. However, you have the ability to displace your muscle fibers, and that's where the work is really going. So you can take chemical energy and turn them into kinetic energy inside your muscles. There is a displacement involved. It's just not where you think. So this hopefully resolves for you this idea of what's going on in that scenario. If you're not displacing something, there's no work done on it. But oftentimes, as a human being, just because you don't move the thing you want to move doesn't mean that your muscle fibers aren't displacing anyway. Okay? So your muscles still contract, they still displace, right? So that energy is going somewhere. It's just going from chemical into your muscles. Are there any questions on that? You're not doing work on the wall, you're doing work on yourself. Question?
If you're lifting weights with an applied force, you're pushing up, so isn't this also applied force? It's also contraction of muscles.
That's right. So in fact, it turns out that all the chemical energy that you exert does not go into the barbell. Some of it goes to heat, right? Some of your muscle fibers contract and then you expend it as heat. If you could actually take all the chemical energy of your breakfast and turn it into kinetic energy, you could run like a 3-second mile. The problem is, of course, is that there's always some waste, right? There's always some that you have to use for just maintaining your biological systems. You're sweating some of it out. The human body is not efficient at all. So the chemical energy, a vast part of it is not actually going into actual physical displacement. It's going into other forms. And by the way, that's necessary if you guys know about entropy, right? You guys talk about that in chemistry?
Yeah.
Okay, this idea of moving towards more disorder, right? So the common thing, you know, the arguments against like evolution and things like that are that how can something go from being more disordered to less disordered? Well, if you drop a plate on the floor and it shatters, of course it's not going to jump back and reassemble itself and jump back on the table, right? But you could glue it together, right, and put it back on the table yourself. But the amount of sweat and heat that you've put out in doing that is actually going to more than make up for the reordering that you did. The universe has actually still become more disordered in that process. Even though you've reassembled that plate and made that more ordered, the universe as a whole, you've sweated out your efforts. So the human body is basically, you get a small little purposeful thing that you do, like picking up a plate or throwing a baseball or whatever, but it's made up for by this waste of energy that you're always sweating out. I don't know if that made any sense. If you haven't heard about entropy, you probably wondered if I, what I was talking about for the last few minutes. But anyway, hopefully somebody got something out of that. Question?
Is the word you did to yourself, you did to your muscles, that
works? Is it what?
Yes,
for sure, because you can't put it back there, right? Right. So by definition, there's an inherent one-wayness, right? You can't. The only way you can get more chemical energy is by eating more, right? You can't put something up on the shelf, right? And then when you're hungry later, you can't take it down and be full again, right? Those are the main reasons why we don't invite those forms of energy into Physics 1, because we want a nice two-way street. You can always get it back and forth. Any other questions?